In 2008, Pixar introduced audiences to Wall-E, the story of a plucky little robot with a heart of gold who manages to save humanity from an empty existence of endless drifting through the stars. Weaving together themes of conservation, anti-consumerism, love for home, and the need for human connection, the movie was an enormous success, grossing over $500 million at the box office. It was universally beloved by audiences and critics alike, winning dozens of awards and receiving even more nominations, including an Oscar nod for the Best Original Screenplay. To date, it is 57th on the IMDb Top 250 Films of All Time. So really, when you look at a film that was this popular, with themes this important and obvious, it kind of forces you to ask the question, why didn't Wall-E change anything? I love Wall-E in a way that's kind of hard to explain. If you've ever heard of hyperpalatable foods, things that literally hack our biology to taste better than any natural food could ever taste, Wall-E is kind of like the movie equivalent of that for me. This movie just works for me. I mean, just look at this guy. Listen to him get disappointed. This is like if you refined cute puppy videos down to some kind of essence and then turned it into meth. From start to finish, Wall-E is like one of the most aggressively pleasant movie experiences you can have. In fact, it's almost too good. It almost makes you wonder if, like with hyperpalatable foods, there's something a little wrong here under the surface. The movie begins following Wall-E, a lovable trash compactor bot. Oh, sorry, I mean waste allocation load lifter Earth class, through an average day on the job. Though he was once one of a legion of identical bots tasked with cleaning up the Earth, Wall-E is now the last of his kind and spends his days sorting an endless ocean of garbage into neat skyscrapers of trash. And he spends his nights tucked away in a shipping container with his pet cockroach and an assortment of beloved relics left by humanity. One day, Wall-E finds a fresh sprout growing inside of a closed fridge. What? How did we not notice this in 2008? Whatever. As fate would have it, immediately after his discovery, Wall-E's life is shaken by an even greater surprise, the arrival of Eve. Eve is some type of scouting bot and far, far more advanced than Wall-E in every regard. Initially, she mostly ignores Wall-E, but after some light flirting, they become friendly and he even shows her his sprout. Oh, that does not sound great. This, however, causes her to go into an idle state as she holds the sprout and waits to be retrieved. When she's picked up by her ship, Wall-E stows away, following Eve back to the Axiom where he discovers what has become of the once masters of the universe. Humanity has now spent generations drifting through the galaxy aboard the enormous spacecraft cruise liner, the Axiom. Ostensibly, the plan was for humanity to take a 5-year space cruise while Wall-E and his mates cleaned up the Earth, but clearly this plan has been abandoned. Instead, they've grown to resemble corpulent toddlers, as they glide everywhere on hovering recliners, slurp meals from their big gulp cups, and keep their eyes glued to screens which provide them a never-ending stream of entertainment. In contrast to Wall-E's earnest love of the things around him, they seem to place no significance on anything. Their constantly mobile existence is mirrored by their constantly mobile minds, which can never linger on anything long enough to care. The only emotions they seem to experience are boredom and dissatisfaction. Due to the diminished state of humanity, the ship's AI autopilot has been able to usurp control over the vessel and everyone on board and has prevented humanity from returning to Earth for hundreds of years. The nominal captain is nothing but a puppet, as helpless and impotent as everyone else. Eventually, it's revealed that the AI's instruction to keep humanity from returning home is based on a 700-year-old message stating that the cleanup operation that Wall-E was a part of had failed and that it would be easier to remain in space than to deal with the mess that had been made of the planet.
Hey there, autopilots. Got some bad news.
But Wall-E's pureness of heart sparks a kind of moral revolution aboard the Axiom, which eventually culminates in a regime change returning control of the ship and of humanity's destiny back into the hands of people. The movie ends with the Axiom returning home, and humanity ready to reclaim their mantle as custodians and shepherds of the Earth, and hopefully do a better job of it than their ancestors. It's an uplifting story, and it was so loved by everybody that we hardly noticed our own growing guts as we watched someone else's story on a giant screen, slurping extra-large fountain drinks and plunging our hands into giant tubs of butter-drenched popcorn. And then we left the theater and, nothing really changed. Not only did Wally not inspire any mass political movements against consumerism, we weren't even self-aware enough to recognize how easily this anti-consumerist film slotted right into our consumerist lifestyle. In the years since, there's been no alteration in our rates of consumption. Well, actually, that's not completely true. It's worse now, as you might have guessed. So what gives? Like, I know that this is just supposed to be a kid's movie, but these are pretty adult themes, and I know lots of adults who really loved this movie. When Abraham Lincoln met Harriet Beecher Stowe, the author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, he reportedly said to her, "So you're the little woman who wrote the book that started this great war." Now certainly he was overstating the case, but it does show that there is historical precedent for works of art leading to real world change, so I think it's a fair question. In his book, Capitalist Realism, Mark Fisher explains how Wally exemplifies inner passivity in media. The term inner passivity was coined by Robert Faller, an Austrian philosopher, and refers to the phenomenon that occurs when a piece of art or technology acts on behalf of the audience or user. The Ur example of this, and the one that Faller most often refers to, is the laugh track, or canned laughter, something that had its heyday in the sitcoms of the 90s and early 2000s.
You were looking?
Well, I'm a cop. It's my training.
Oh, you know, Robert, it may look like we're not busy, but get out.
The point of laugh track interpassivity was to subtly convince the viewer that what they were witnessing was significantly funnier than it actually was to them. After all, this guy is having the time of his life.
Get out.
But Wally's interpassivity is a little less benign. As Fisher points out, what Wally the film performs on our behalf is the anti-consumerism that is its obvious message, leaving us to consume freely. Now think about that, because it's a little odd, right? Like, if you're the CEO of By and Large, the massive corporation that owns everything in the movie, then you'd basically look at this movie like it was a propaganda hit piece, but at the same time you'd be noticing your revenues increasing and your stock prices going up. How is this happening? We don't typically think of negative propaganda benefiting the thing that it is explicitly against. Slavoj Žižek is another philosopher, and on this subject he claims that in contemporary society, the prevailing ideology is that of cynicism. People no longer believe in ideological truth. They do not take ideological propositions seriously. But even if we do not take things seriously, even if we keep ironical distance, we are still doing them. Žižek calls it ideology, but it might be easier to say that our society is one in which we no longer possess ideals. An ideal could be described as some kind of motivating vision for the good that inspires us to do certain things and to restrain ourselves from doing other things. Maybe you've heard the expression, a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down.
For a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down.
It's a phrase that's been used frequently to embrace popular trends in entertainment, under the assumption that you can somehow marry people's basic desire for simple pleasures with more complex goods as a way of getting your foot in the door. But while this idea may work in theory, when observed in reality, it seems that while the sugar is consumed as eagerly as ever, the medicine, the aspirational ideal that was supposed to be the reason for making this thing, never seems to do its work. Rather than raising awareness or galvanizing any kind of idealism, it seems like these products do more to defang real idealism by allowing it to play itself out within the fantasy world of the film. They trick us into thinking that it's our beliefs that matter. As long as we believe the right things, it doesn't really matter what we do. This is a cope. As a result, deep commitments and ideals are transmogrified into mere consumer preferences. In so many of these productions, the villain is actually an extension of something within ourselves, a character defect or a psychological flaw. We project our shortcomings onto the characters, and in the film's resolution, we are able to enjoy the catharsis of a psychological transformation that hasn't occurred. We could call this therapeutic projection. The humans of Wally have learned their lesson, and all will now be right with the world. We, on the other hand, leave the theater no different than we entered it. The disarming passivity of this type of media applies to other kinds of concerns as well. In the 2021 movie Don't Look Up, two scientists try to alert the world to an impending meteor collision. In doing so, they encounter a vast matrix of perverse incentives and hyper-real barriers which prevent humanity from being able to engage with even such a straightforward existential threat as an oncoming space missile. Ultimately, the protagonists fail and the Earth is destroyed. Many have commented that this film is an allegory for climate crisis and global warming, but this reading is too narrow. If the film proves anything, it is that our current social order is ill-equipped to grapple with any existential threat at all. ironically, Don't Look Up may have contributed to the exact same culture of carelessness that it was attempting to draw attention to. Instead of waking us from our slumber, it became another ripple across the surface of our collective dreaming. In fact, it may have even hurt its cause by acclimating us yet again to think of existential threats as stuff that only happens in the movies. Here, the continuing research into and development of AI is illustrative. Despite literal decades of warnings in the forms of books and movies, and despite the terrified cries of people deeply embedded in the industry who are begging us to halt this research, and despite more realistic but no less terrifying modern theories about how an AI might permanently extinguish the human race, such as engineering a supervirus that could wipe us all out, we are still charging full steam ahead. And while this may all end in disaster, in the meantime, at least it's enabled some tech bros to boost their salaries by taking two or sometimes even more high-paying jobs at different companies and allowing ChatGPT to handle the workload. Don't worry guys, I'm sure this won't lead to anything bad. In each of these cases, what is most strongly condemned is our ability to live in a way that completely contradicts our held ideals. This is not so strange in itself, there's often a gap between our lives and our ideals. What is perverse is the size of that gap coupled with how comfortable we are with it. Ultimately, the reason that WALL-E didn't change anything is that it's simply an entertainment product. It's not and was never meant to do anything. And while that's an extremely obvious conclusion, I think that it deserves more attention than we give to it. Movies like WALL-E don't exist to solve the problems that they highlight. They exist to make us feel better about them. I can't help but imagining future historians looking back on the cultural products of this era and saying to one another, "They saw so many of these dangers coming. Why didn't they do anything to stop them?" I think that if we were actually able to respond and answer the question, we'd have to say, "We just didn't realize that we were supposed to do something. We thought the point was just to enjoy the movie."